In case you have already seen my flagship battle part 2, you already know quite well what I think about the HTC U11. But if you haven't, or if you just want to know how good this phone is on its own, I would say this review is just it. And that's why we should switch and talk about the first thing as always, the design and the build quality. And if I would have to point out two things where I'm not the biggest fan of in terms of design, then the first thing would have been that the device just isn't as compact as I think it could be. Because comparing it here with, for example, the OnePlus 3T that has after all a 400 mAh bigger battery, you see that the device is taller, wider, and also thicker. So just not quite as compact as I think it could be, especially with also quite big bezels. And as you can see them here, they are definitely noticeable. Because my brother actually thought at first that due to quite big curve, it would have been an edge display, but this is not the case. Now the second thing would have been that the buttons are a little bit lower placed than I would want to, but that's already it, because the build quality is absolutely top notch. Nothing creaks, the back doesn't really feel hollow at all, the buttons have a nice tactile and also very good meaty click, placement is also great, and even though the device just isn't the smallest and compact one, because it's after all also a little bit thick and one-hand usability isn't the best, I have to say it feels incredibly nice in the hand, very smooth with great transitions to all sides with the curves here on the back. It just sits so right in the hand. Now the fingerprint reader, I have to say, is actually quite good if I don't have the most sweaty hands like I have here in the studio right now. Usually it works absolutely good, absolutely fast. I would say it's a very good one after all. There is a vibration, but I would wish for an option to turn it off, but it is not a deal breaker or anything like that. So otherwise, we have on the back, of course, a protruding camera, but just a little bit, so nothing to really bother about. Two LEDs. We have the microphone and the SD card tray along with nothing on the left, but on the bottom, USB Type-C, microphone again, and one of the two dual speakers because the lower one is for the mids and the bass and the earpiece for the highs, where we also see somewhere at the top the notification LED and of course capacitive buttons. So this would have been pretty much it. I like the design, even though it's maybe not super compact, and I definitely like the build quality a lot. Now, what is there to say about the display? I can already tell you that this is an absolutely flagship worthy top-notch display. Because even though we can only change the color temperature, this is fine. Because one thing that actually surprised me, that this is one of the very first HTC phones where I have no complaints about the calibration. Usually it always seemed a little bit off to me, which is not the case here. Because also a very low amount of IPS glow, which makes it one of the more high quality displays. And it's maybe not the brightest one with just 475 lux. It's still good enough, I would say. White point can be set and the overall calibration is great. And since this is on 1440p IPS display, this is also brutally sharp and absolutely a joy to use. Now, what about that dual speaker setup that I already mentioned? Let's check it. The speaker is easily a very good because it's very loud and nice in terms of sound quality. Maybe a little bit richer would have been nice, but it's absolutely no problem because it feels very nicely balanced. There is though only a great if there would have been a front-facing speaker setup, which it's not, and therefore it's at least a very good, if you get what I mean. The headphone jack, I have to say though, you only can achieve with the adapter, and with that one, I have to actually say I was a little bit disappointed from what I heard, because after all, I wouldn't give it more than a good. It is not nearly as loud as something like a OnePlus 3T or a OnePlus 5, which is something very important for me since I want to drive some more, let's say a little bit more demanding headphones. For earphones, absolutely fine, and with the included ones you will get an absolutely great experience, but just the headphone jack on its own with the adapter is not as good as I thought it would be, but still good. So yeah, that's something. Now, performance wise, I have to say this is after the Sony Xperia XZ the next best device that you can get, because as you can see, apps launch very quickly and it's definitely a very snappy device. It is maybe just not in terms of transitions because Sony tweaked them a little bit, not quite as snappy feeling, but very very fast at all times and also super smooth. And this is one of the major points, because as you can see here, everything at all times is absolutely smooth and super consistent. And that's pretty much the best experience in overall that you can get. Of course, multitasking will be super strong, as you can here see. This is absolutely not a problem. There is actually even a 6 GB version, even though I don't think that's necessary, because the overall experience here is so buttery smooth, so fast, so responsive, that I don't really know what else to say. And that's why I won't, because next thing would have been to be talked about is the gaming performance, which is also pretty much on the very highest level that I've seen so far. You can play all the games with absolute very high frame rates, with pretty much no frame drops at all, very consistent. And this in 1440p, so the Snapdragon 845 can handle this quite easily. Since the device is a little bit bigger, it actually can dissipate heat a little bit better, and therefore it actually doesn't even get quite warm. So all games with the pretty much best experience for gaming, absolutely top. Now, battery life, how good is that one? First of all, the charge, 1 hour and 40. Of course, that always can fluctuate a little bit. It could actually be a little bit faster if you charge it a little bit longer, but this is still an absolute top value. Maybe YouTube drain wasn't the very best one out there. I've seen better ones, but where it makes up for that is the standby drain, which is absolutely phenomenal. Very one of the very best ones, especially on Nougat. Many phones can't even achieve that so good anymore. So I'm happy to see that. And also that is the reason why on mobile data, the drain is very good, because there I would have spec'd so out, let's say 5.5 to even 6 hours. The only reason why I'm not giving it the great plus rating is because it's not really much better on Wi-Fi, because usually the gap is a little bit bigger, but therefore, since mobile data is so good and Wi-Fi is still great, easy great, maybe even almost a great plus. So I'm highly impressed, even though the battery is so small, it actually trumps many phones that have a bigger battery or a smaller display. So yeah, they did a great job with optimization. And thanks to my camera overheating once again, I had to take a small break, which made me completely lose my flow. Things start to get weird from now on. Fingerprint reader doesn't get accepted because it's too sweaty. And I would say, let's just try to finish the last few minutes to get through this review. Okay, the software would be the next part, which is something that I actually just want to briefly mention, because known from HTC, you get a stock Android-like launcher, something very similar to that with a quite stock Android-like look. Of course, quick settings are customizable as well, because personalization actually, along with a quite nice theming engine, is very important for them. Otherwise, you get a little bit of an enhanced stock Android, not too much more, a few gestures here and there. And one thing that I haven't mentioned yet so far, which is the pressure-sensitive sight, which allows you to use EdgeSense. Why didn't I mention it once? Because I just think it's something quite gimmicky. I didn't really use it once on purpose, and I won't ever use it because, okay, it's nice to have, but I don't need to use it, and that's okay with me. What is actually way more important is the update support and general software support, because the software is quite clean, quite capable, all the useful features are there, and you get quite early your updates and quite good, because I actually got just one today. So on this side, everything is fine. So let's just check the next thing, the camera. And I have to say, I have some mixed feelings about that, and I will let you know why. But I also want to let you know is that maybe I'm just not a camera pro or something like that, and my results could be weaker. But as you can see here, I had way too many shots that just weren't properly in focus. You have to be a little bit further away, and then it's the white balance, as you can see here and here, that just fluctuates way too much in my opinion. Because if you can get it in the right position to be sharp, you still have the issue that I'm just too warm now and maybe not quite now. But as you can see indoors, it can actually produce absolutely great shots. But overall, I won't give it more than a very good, because I just had way too many of these, and you can see so many examples here. The quality is just a little bit flaky. Sometimes very good, sometimes great, sometimes just okay. So I'm not 100% impressed. It can potentially be great, but yeah, in my normal experience, it just isn't. But I think that's good enough. So let's quickly check the video here and what I have to say about that one. The artifacting in general on this camera is just a little bit too much. That's the only thing that keeps me saying that it is a great front-facing video, because as you can see, it just artifacts a little bit too much. Quality itself is quite okay. Like I said, you have to be a little bit further away. Same also goes for this video. So yeah, it's fine, but I'm just not blown away as I maybe should be. I've definitely seen better front-facing cameras. Now, low light qualities, I have to say, those are great, because as you can see here, with or without the flash, top, and here it maintains to be very sharp, detailed, and here things are way better. But outside, once again, you will see this in quite a few shots, the exposure and the white balance is a little bit off, because as you can see here, you can achieve great shots without any issues. The autofocus is usually quite reliable. I would say HDR sometimes needs a little bit longer, which is not the best one in terms of shutter speeds, but usually it's fine. But here, as you can see here, a little bit too warm and then too cold. And as you can see, this is almost the same shot, and I've got this result, as you can see here, just way too often. And then the next thing would have been the exposure, because for example, here also white balance, this is too cold, where this is more right. And I'm just not quite convinced. The camera, like I said, can produce great shots, but maybe you have to know what you do. Maybe you have to use manual mode. But personally, as someone like me, I don't want to use that. I just want to point and shoot and get great results. And in general, I just got way too many too warm pictures. But here is the next thing. This looks still fine and just a little bit higher, and it's completely underexposed. And this, along with the white balance, is just something that I've seen way too often. This is not correct in terms of colors. They should be way way warmer. This is just now too flat and too pale. Once again here, as you can see. Yeah, I would say the samples speak for themselves. Yes, it can be great, but at least for me, with my normal testing that I usually do on all other cameras, it did not quite fully convince me the way it should maybe. Because yes, once again here, this is just a little bit too flaky. And maybe it's just me, I don't know. Now 4K would be really good, but as you can see here, faster movement or just movement in general leads us to artifacting quite a lot, as you can see. So this I would like to maybe have seen updated with maybe a higher bitrate or something, because as you can see here, the autofocus works super nice and it's subtle with a one direction, not really a pump or something like that. I like it. And also, as you can see here, the footage is quite shake free. So even that is good. And the quality on its own, which is something which you will see in just a few seconds, is absolutely top. Because autofocus is reliable, yes, a little bit of lens flare because of the sun, but the qualities otherwise are absolutely there. 1080p is also almost not really much more blurry, so also that one can convince. So in terms of videos, I am absolutely fine. And there I will give it a grade, but in general the camera was not quite what I wanted or what I wished for to see, because what I've heard from so many other people. So maybe you trust them more, absolutely no problem, and I guess it is an absolutely one of the very best cams, but maybe not the most reliable ones. Now, in terms of pros and cons, here I have to point out the top design and build quality. We have a very good fingerprint reader, a top-notch flagship level display, a very good speaker after all, a good headphone jack. I actually thought it would be better, but still, the performance though is absolutely top three. We get a great battery life, very good software, and in terms of cameras, like I said, very good front-facing cam, a great low-light cam, a potentially great main cam, and a great video cam after all, if not for the artifacting. Now, what's not a great, as you can see here, not a whole lot. It could be a little bit more compact, a little bit thinner maybe. The bezels are quite big. We don't have a headphone jack, but at least an adapter included. And my kind of issue here is, for the camera, the wonky white balance and exposure. But that is. And pretty much everyone else said the camera is great, so if you trust them, and I'm not denying that, the camera definitely can be great, and if you get proper lightings and so on, if you don't maybe take too much on the wonkiness of the exposure weapons, you get an absolutely top-notch flagship level camera as well. And then you can just see that all the qualities are absolutely great in pretty much every aspect, and maybe the weakest one is like good, or I mean very good, which just shows me that I have to say, as an overall package, I would actually say that this is the best flagship out so far. Yes, not in terms of design, because there are definitely something like things like, for example, the S8 or G6 that are way more compact. But if just the compact feel isn't the most important part for you, but you want the great display, top performance, great battery life, which is something that you, for example, don't get on the S8 for, at least in my experience, a great camera, a nice software, and overall in a super nice package, you will definitely get this. And especially in the US, where the price is at around $600, even the price is right and the value seems fine. So overall, top package, and I can easily recommend it. It's maybe not my first choice, because I just personally wish for something smaller, but I prefer smaller phones in general. But just leaving that aside, being more objective, I don't see any package that is more complete on a better level than the HTC U11. Now, feel free to disagree with me down there in the comments. I have no problems with that. Also, things like, for example, my flaky camera shots, but that is what it is. I hope you liked the review. Maybe give it a thumbs up and a subscription. But otherwise, I would say, let's have a nice day. Bye.